our friend, the speaking is Alexei Morozov, and he will be speaking for AGT conjecture. AGT conjecture.
So first of all, it's a great pleasure for me to be again in this country after so many years. See all of you. And I also appreciate the privilege to speak on the first paper, so that I can be completely responsible for whatever I say. In any case, I'll
just not specifically arrange.
In case I'll be saying only some absolutely trivial things, still some of them can be wrong. So I'm going to speak about this remarkable discovery, which I think is one of the most interesting things during the last year, the conjecture. I like it very much because it brings together several different fields. And most important, in all these fields, there are formulas. So that's a rare case when we have something quantitative and still non-trivial. And we can take various formulas which we know to all these fields, which a priori are absolutely unrelated and look similar to many of us for many years. Now we understand finally that they are really the same. And this is pleasant and quite interesting because we still. It is still quite difficult to understand why they are the same and what exactly some say. So the AGT conjecture relates in its original form, just conformal blocks. And we're now calling class of functions. And it is related at least to a few other fields. One of them is matrix models, another is Zeidler-Prudhomme theory, something called Hurwitz theory, Liouville, and in fact some other issues. So this whole thing became possible after remarkable discovery in this corner, when it appeared that one can introduce these two extra parameters, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. And the whole picture, of course, depends on this parameter, so there are various interesting limits when something happens to these parameters. There are also many interesting limits when other parameters of the theory are changed, like dimensions and central charges, which exist here. And one of the illustrations is such that though we clearly are sure now that all these relations hold somehow, there is still nothing similar to a proof of it. Actually, the relation itself is proved, as well as I understand, only in two very distinguished cases. One of them is the case of toric conformal blocks. Which is at this point which related to Calogero integrable system. And another case is the limit when central charge goes to infinity while all other dimensions are kept at fixed. And this case is quite important because in both cases just the proof goes by just direct technical proof that the two things are the same, just term by term and all the expansions. So in this case is especially nice because in this case the quantities which we are analyzing are just heterogeneic series. And in fact, this is another aspect which is so interesting about this whole story, because today we understand that what we get from this AGT conjecture is a non-trivial generalization of hypergeometric series. It is known for years that conformal blocks provide for us some generalization of hypergeometric series, which I remind are the most general special functions that we know and use in physics so far, so we badly need generalizations, and this is what is in principle provided by conformal blocks. But it was maybe not very clear to what extent this is a right generalization. So now this whole picture implies that indeed it is. What I'm going to discuss is just some, let us see, one possible program to try to find a general proof of the conjecture, not appealing to all the same philosophical things like unknown six-dimensional theory, which contains all the knowledge, of course, but I would be more interested in something much more technical and concrete. And the program which I keep in mind, well, there are many programs of this type, but one of them which I find also interesting goes along this line.
And let's say, would you accept if someone constructed the 6D theory? Would you then be happy?
I'd be happy if somebody constructs it in constructive way, so that we can really
prove that the quantum field theory in six dimensions.
No, the notion of proof is very is different for different people. Yeah, I think that what
I think even at the physics level of rigor, no one claims.
That's not what I'm saying. Just I think that for real understanding of any fields, you should have many proofs, many different proofs by different means. So I think that what I'm going to discuss is not by no means in contradiction with any other approach. They are all complementary to each other, because the story is in fact complicated. It is important to have a view on it from different sides. And just today I want to emphasize one particular approach, which is just absolutely technical, concrete, and without just any philosophy. But of course, instead it will have many other drawbacks.
It always starts with philosophy. Our subject 150 years ago was called philosophy.
And we are coming back to its origins.
Natural.
Not that I don't like
also
philosophy.
Called metaphysics.
Now it's unnatural philosophy.
Okay, so and
what about four point functions here?
Yeah, what kind of So what's the
question? You just said that you don't know things that one point function.
Well, it was proved.
So it was proved for the four point function this year?
In my opinion, not, yeah. But again, this depends
on. You mean proved in all order?
No. Proved in all orders, of course, but I think that this is not what is really important to prove in all orders or not in all
orders. In
the real thing is to understand what happens.
In orders in what? In Q, in
Q,
epsilon?
In Q.
So exactly in epsilon and Q expansion.
Yeah, for example.
So
then
each term.
So
if it's exactly in epsilon and Q expansion, then each term in Q expansion is certain integral of moduli space of these tensors, and you are telling me it has been derived from conformal block that order Q to the power n is an integral or moduli space.
It is not derived, this is the problem.
But you said it was proved.
It's a recursion satisfied by the size.
It is proved. It is proved. We looked at one term and another term and the third term and so on. But
and you get moduli space of
the same level was shown for the four point functions.
My question was simple.
That's a nice integral.
Yeah. Let's continue. I think we'll discuss later.
Father and collaborators gave, I think, a proof that for the one-point function of the torus, the two sides are the same.
Yeah, exactly. One-point function on the torus, no question. Yes. Because there are 2 points in my list.
I'm not sure that this is extended.
Sorry. It was not four-point function on the sphere, but it was one-point function on the torus. And there, Valotti, Fatiev, and Finov, they gave a detailed, complete proof using this homological recursion relation. And these are the only two cases, in my opinion, which were any proof exists. But I repeat that what I think is more important is to understand what is the background. So what are reasons for all this to work? So I repeat once again that we know some deep reasons starting from the six-dimensional theory, but I think it is also important to find one day some more down-to-earth reasons, which are like more technical. I'll try to write some formulas later, but just to say clearly what I mean here is that this arrow will be the story about Otsenka-Fatiev integrals. This story about is roughly about the graph Waffle phases and matrix models. and these two things are more or less understandable, I think. The real problem lives here, not at the moment. And for this, it is also important to remember that this single point consists, in fact, of at least four different kinds of formulas. I don't know how I should order them, so I'll be chaotic, yeah? there are these LMS integrals, which come somewhere from regularization of modular spaces, but just what we need at this level of formulas are just concrete expressions. So these are some integrals.
They're also MNS
integrals. I can never decide what is the right set of names at this particular integral, but of course the whole story was done by the four people, and then there is this some polynomial standing here, which is probably not so essential. The real secret behind these integrals, as everybody knows, is a very special choice of contours. So that we should pick up some very special sets of residues there, so that there are some x, x1, x0, a, then next x's will take values either epsilon 1 or epsilon 2, so there will be a tau, so the production of epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, so one thing is here over a, another is a plus epsilon 1, that can be plus epsilon 2, and so on. So there is some picture made out of this of these things. And the numerator is designed in such a way that all the Jung diagrams appear, so that you such configuration gives contribution 0, and so on. And so this led to what is literally called cross of functions, I think this time. This is a bilinear sum over Jung diagrams. So two Jung diagrams arise because there is a tower of x's growing over A in this way. So this thing makes for us a Jung diagram. And another possibility is that some other chain of x's will go over minus A. And so this will give this will give another Jung diagram. So it is some linear sum here. And
Because that's for the future.
So, yeah.
Because that's future.
Yeah. And well, if it is not SC2, it would be more complicated, there would be change. So instead of this, there would be expanding minus A alpha product over all alphas belonging to the group, so there will be many more integrals.
I think most important, actually, Alexei, so I interrupt you. On this side, as far as I understand, all the formulas, all the prescriptions are completely null. So when you said that there is a problem on this side, I don't understand what you mean.
I didn't come to it.
Oh, okay.
Still, these are two different formulas. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And these two are, of course, related. Everybody I know, I think, here knows this by heart how this identity looks. And on this side, it should be compared with something with a similar sum. It's associated with this diagram. And so we have some fields at the ends. Yeah, and in between runs descendants of some primary field. They are labeled descendants by Jung diagram acting on the primary vertex operator. Yeah, so this means that there is L minus 1 to some power, L minus 2 to some power, L minus 3 to some power, and so on. And these coefficients form for us this Jung diagram. And this is the Shapovalov matrix, yeah, so Q delta. This scalar product of L minus. So here we have a bilinear sum over Jung diagrams. Here we have a bilinear sum over Jung diagrams. And this AGT.
So can you state the state in the representation graph sort of labeled by a single partition or by two partitions?
The state is labeled by a single partition, but the formula contains two.
So
are you identifying
by the primary on this side?
Not term by term. Of course. The sum here is equal to the sum here. So, but let me come back to this point. Yeah? So there are these two other types of representations. One of them, which I think someone mentioned already, which is in terms of topological theory. So some sum of the day. So this form, which has some direct and also spiritual relation to all these things, and this leads somewhere in this direction, which I will not touch today.
That's for epsilon 1 equals epsilon 2.
No, this particular, you know this formula well for epsilon 1 equals minus epsilon 2, but almost for sure it will be so good.
There should be some formula like that with some insertions where epsilon 1 is not equal.
Yeah, exactly. And what is maybe more important to my today's story is that this whole thing that, as something already told us, is cleverly written also in this form. But this actually is roughly a logarithm of that. This is, well, you can always do it, but of course from these formulas it's almost impossible to write something clever for f itself. And it is this formula which is going to be directly related to the Zeta-Beta theory, because of course this f satisfies just the usual Zeta-Beta description. This means that in terms of something, with the same integral from there. So this f is going to satisfy this kind of relations.
We want to satisfy that, or it's obvious? I mean, I, for example, don't know why.
I don't know about obvious. It does satisfy.
Yeah.
It is important that this f depends on a's, of course, but on epsilon 1 and epsilon
2. I mean, when we turn on the epsilons, it's not obvious to be that.
No, nothing is obvious in this sense. Yeah, that's the problem. but just we are collecting facts. Concerning what is obvious, just the philosophical.
No, no, what I meant was, let me be precise, I'm sorry. What I meant was that when I take a limit and pick up the F0 term, which is the vector potential itself, so I put the epsilon to 0 in F, there is a nice argument which tells you why it has to be vector. There is an argument.
So there are three levels, yeah? Everybody knows that this thing satisfies this type of relation. Yeah, this is vector theory itself. Yeah?
There is a nice argument for that.
This thing is what Samson called young function in his talk, yeah? So this he didn't say, but it obviously satisfies the same kind of relation, because lambda changes. Lambda depends on some one. I'll tell you what it is in this case. And in fact, it was already mentioned several times here. It's like a different language. And in this case, such lambda also exists. This is almost checked, as I would say so. But what is important, it follows directly from the story about matrix models. What is the reason for such representation from the point of view of modular spaces and all this stuff is not very clear.
The next question about the Pataev papers that you said. Did they actually derive that integral in expansion, or they claim that this integral integrated will give the answer?
There exists some old argument by Alexei Morozov, yeah, about conformal blocks on the topics, yeah? Okay. So there is some recurrent relation. Well, we can write it down, but there is some recurrent relation. So what they did, they checked that these integrals also satisfy the same recurrent relation.
Oh, I see. So they applied the recurrent relation of Alyosha to this integral,
so
ordered by order.
They saw that this integral also satisfied.
I thought they evaluated.
Just by accurate examination, roughly they were doing this error, but with some additional comments.
Okay.
That's a brilliant argument, but no, I can repeat it if you like. But it's
No. I just wanted to know how did they end.
Yeah, but technically this is what they did. Theory, you quantify something on this Riemann surface, yeah, and depending on what was the surface, we will get different four-dimensional theories. So there's no surprise that we have one of the same thing here, roughly, and many different things here. So plenty of different theories. What is, however, a little unpleasant is that what we can pick up at the left-hand side is something quite restricted. So first of all, we can take all the list. Type of from diagrams or conformal blocks, for example. I don't understand what we should associate with this kind of conformal block on the right hand side. It seems that simply the right counterpart doesn't exist, that there should be further generalizations of the right hand side to describe this story. And this, of course, is important because from the point of view of conformal blocks and dualities and so on, all these things should come together. So this set, this very nice set of the class of functions is certainly not sufficient to work on this.
Let's think it's not kind of S-duality action on the other one. It's just new.
What he means is that we need to control the theory of tracking another one.
Yeah. No.
Sorry, can you say it louder?
Sure.
I'm just asking for the last
priorities. No, you keep the first priority.
I know you. Can you just say it louder?
I said that we don't
we don't have sufficient technology to deal with the tri-fundamental hypermodal.
Even in the SU2 case?
Yeah.
In the SU2 case?
Even in the SU2
problem
is that these integrals were derived for by using particular quantification of the moduli space, which use SU2 as a subgroup of U2. You can't try fundamentals.
Yeah, what is worse, not we don't know this way to do this, we simply don't know the upside.
But we know it exists.
Don't exist at all.
It exists. We know it
exists. We know that it exists exactly, but we don't know what it is. This is exactly what I'm saying. So this set of things should be further extended.
Sorry, actually, can I take the liberty to ask Ivy Moore and Nikita on this subject once we touched it? Since in n equals 2 case, this is a free theory, can't we simply compute equivariant index of the hypers? And that should be the corresponding ingredient.
No, you can certainly define in the theory what you want to compute. It's just that
the theoretical condition is actually a bit tricky to impose. These are not just tri-fundamental hypermultiples. They are tri-fundamental half hypermultiples.
Okay.
So, for example, like,
but they're free.
Yes.
So, and we're just introducing equivariant parameters for global SV2 symmetries. So why can't one run technology of equivariant counting and this free theory?
You know, to know how do they act on one vector.
That's an important discussion.
Why don't you come to your talk?
We have a discussion after the talk.
You're chairman.
Okay. Yeah, I'm the chairman. Yeah, listen.
Okay. So another well-known problem is that we associate this whole story with ignoring this kind of feature. So the four-point component block is just this thing. And of course, we have all these features here. And we can do it, but everybody here knows that it doesn't quite work in the sense that we cannot associate some reasonable conformal blocks to this kind of diagrams. The story is that only for this very special values of external particles here, we have a reasonable version of conformal blocks for W algebras, so beyond the rational. And this is a kind of an opposite situation where this piece of where knowledge is insufficient already here. There are some fundamental reasons in conformal theory which don't allow us to generalize it. Again, the problem is that certainly the generalizations should exist, moreover, they exist at this level. So it looks like that that the real theory behind all this is still something different, neither this nor this. And as some people guess, I believe that this theory is just a theory of free fields, and which contains all this, but not all the things are smoothly reduced now. Anyhow, so let me return to this point and start from here.
There is one other thing which I like about the thing. There is also the version of all that stuff for full correlation, not conformal block, but full correlation. And that one, in terms of free field, this comment, then I will have hard time to understand. Are you saying that we can write also a full correlator?
No, first of all, we should explicitly write the statements which we want.
I mean, left-right correlator.
I understand, but what kind of exact relation do you keep in mind?
So I thought Bestun computed something there, which is a moduli square.
Vasily computed something, that's absolutely right. But, but it still needs to be understood, and generalized, and it should be not a simple calculation, but some.
Do you understand it in terms of free fields?
I think that with this very limited information which we have about this calculation, so that's just a single model and single in a single situation, two few free parameters to me. We can adjust it definitely, this result, but it will not be informative because what we need is a penalty. Yeah. Anyhow, what the AGT in this narrow sense of the word, which I mean, transcends conformal blocks. And the story about conformal blocks is just a pure, pure group theory. And the problem is that, no, it's not a problem, since you know all this, but just you should remember that this a little unusual group field theory, because Grassol algebra, W algebra, further, have non-trivial commutification. Yeah? So this is the old story, which we know from Crack and Zeiberg, and from many other places. So the usual commutification is this one, yeah? And this is not true for Grassol algebra, because only this thing is true, but already delta alpha 0 is something that's real. So in our physical language, this is what we call an operator product of two operators ending point 0 and point and point q. So operator product is defined by these type of relations, so they are more complicated. And this change is important to, so that the new Grassol algebra has the same central charge as the original one. So that's the underground reason for writing this. And this is, of course, is just rewriting this trick of integration of stress tensor around two points, 0 and q. And all these coefficients come just from expanding z minus q to the power 3 plus 2 in properties of q. But anyhow, this makes the whole group theory here slightly unusual. Just what we normally have here, so if we have a highest weight representation, and if we multiply two highest weight representations, so first of all, if we take two highest weights in the usual commutification, we again have a highest weight. Well, then we can build our representation out of it, and we'll discover that the product of two representations is in fact a composition of many different things. For the case of Grassol, everything is different. So, first of all, we know that this is not the case. That if we take two Verma models and multiply them, we get a single Verma model, a single representation. Or again, the word get is, we should interpret carefully, so we can declare that this will be a single Verma model. In principle, if you apply projection, you apply your projection.
You know, there is a notion of that you take a fusion of Verma modules and you decompose it as a direct integral over a reducible system.
Yes,
you can do.
But again, there is a possibility to input this whole thing in a single Verma model in generic situation.
You didn't say it was irreducible.
Yeah, I don't say it is irreducible, but generically it isn't irreducible. If we start from arbitrary dimensions, it will be irreducible. More instead, we can start from two Verma models with dimensions delta 1 and delta 2, and the result will be a Verma model with arbitrary dimension, which has nothing to do with these two as arbitrary parameters. Moreover, usually from this type of relation, we would conclude that the new dimension is a sum of two, yeah? But because of this term, we cannot conclude this. Instead, what we can say is that this is an expression saying us what is V1 times L minus 1 V2 if we know what is V1 times V2. So instead of giving for us this result, this central relation, simply tells us what is the expression for this in terms of this. Moreover, situation gets, so once again, we lose a lot of control over products of representations going to Grassauer algebra. So first of all, we don't know where the result lies, wherever we like. But at least at the level of Grassauer, we still have a control in the sense that if we know what happened to the highest weight, so if we declare that this is some sum, it is not the highest weight at all itself, but it is some state in a given Bernoulli model. So if we know this, we know at least everything else, because we know what this is, and from this we can also deduce that what happens to all other elements. So if we have a freedom to postulate to choose this delta, in fact we also have original freedom to choose what is beta zero, but then after that all the rest is defined by Grassauer algebra. Situation gets worse for W algebras, where
you have to apply projection onto the representation delta. So
it is equal in the sense that algebra acts in the same way here and here.
But this is in Hirschhorn's story. So in the tensor product of two representations, of course, you can project out onto a reducible representation.
No, this is what I'm trying to say. That what you get here is any Verma model. So instead of this, you can write that this is a direct sum over all possible deltas. Mm-hmm. For example, with arbitrary coefficients, this is not arbitrary.
You're probably saying that some other representation, so you will get some particular representation.
Yeah. Yeah. And here you
what he's saying, usually you get some particular representations of right hand side. Here, whatever you multiply on the right hand side, you will get everything.
Yeah.
That's what he's saying. Let's multiply two spin once, okay? You will get maximum spin two. Okay? On the right hand side. Here, if you multiply, you will get everything on the right hand side.
Means that if you decompose,
you will be everything. Yeah.
But it's not a single one, it's a direct sum.
No, it's everything.
No, but you get everything. What I'm saying is,
moreover, with arbitrary coefficients. What are the restrictions on the coefficients?
Not arbitrary.
Yeah, what are the restrictions?
Of course, you have to.
If we forget about the degenerate model,
you have to put it in a framework where you can put a scalar product on the tensor product of representations. This is tricky, and the only thing which I think I understand a little bit is what is called confusion. So that is, you have to work not really on the pairs of pairs in the Euclidean picture, you have to work on the unit circle, and you're doing intervals.
Yeah, but
this is a story, I'm pretty sure, I know more or less how it works, that you can do the story as Hirschhorn, where you just get a direct integral with very specific coefficients, a very specific measure of integration in the decomposition of the tensor product of two representations into reducible. It's not arbitrary at all, anything.
Okay, but what's going on is that the measure of integration is not given.
Let me ask a very formal question. I am confused with logic, because on the left hand side, we have a tensor product of two modules, and so the algebra F. So it cannot be sum with arbitrary coefficient. It should be something, we give it to
That's exactly the point.
What is equal to one thing, right? Well, just to
commutation relations of the algebra tell you nothing about this. I think what Brook says is that if you realize these are more models in terms of something, like, I don't know, three fields on a ring of surface, so then of course you will get some concrete decompositions with concrete coefficients. But if the only thing which you have are commutation relations, you can put here arbitrary coefficients.
Okay. This is a vector space, the modules, so the Lie algebra acts. So if you multiply modules, tensor product, you get.
But for this, you should first specify what are the vector spaces. So
there are modules.
You need additional data. You need to put on the left hand side indeed need some, for example, scale-up program.
And this you can do in many different ways.
Your left side is also arbitrary. The left side arbitrary.
But
single thing can be arbitrary.
Everybody agrees.
Yeah, I'm trying to say it's a very simple thing. That just no commutation relation of the Rossor algebra, we know nothing. No.
Absolutely.
Not too much about multiplication of representations. And the repeat situation gets even worse for W algebras, where these extensions are longer, so for W3 you will get here W-2 also, and it will not be enough to, even if we know how what we do with the highest weights, we will not be able to say what happens to all other elements of representations. For W3 we need to postulate what is W-1. And just for this discussion, let me just remind you that even to get what we usually get about Grasshopper algebras, we need to postulate at least one additional thing, that this thing acts like V over the Q on V1, V2. Yeah, but doesn't follow from Grasshopper algebra itself. This is what we say is nature for us in topological theory, but for example, we don't know nothing what substitutes it cleverly and universally in the case of W algebras, and this is one of the problems behind generalizing this to SVM on the left hand side.
You need more cues, right?
You need more cues and you need more principles. This is a physical principle. We need to know what the W geometry or whatever. Yeah, and these are the things where different people cannot agree themselves. So with Grasshopper we agreed what is this kind of additional postulate for W. There are different versions of the concept.
What you need is some, well, it's a big geometric way of twisting by some, say, W group elements.
In the W algebra, does it follow naturally from cosmology by Hamiltonian reduction?
No. That's a possible construction. Nobody said it's unique.
That's a possibility
to derive everything from cosmology algebras. Of course, you will have some definite answers, but somebody else will get different definite answers, and they all should have counterparts on your right-hand side here. So you should have the same freedom here, and it is not
there is a freedom on the right-hand side.
So the conformal blocks would be for W algebras would depend on this kind of additional definitions. Unless one possibility is to put the special states everywhere, then it is quite something, and then we know what it consists of here. Yeah? So for SUN with special states here, it exactly coincides with exactly Nikita's SUN functions. Yeah? But if we try to generalize it, it will use more freedom. One would put here not special state but something else, there is no unique definition of conformal blocks. There are many different definitions, and so they probably should have counterpart on the right hand side. Maybe. Yeah.
I say, so typically the integrals on the right hand side are not convergent, there are residues at infinity. If you pick those residues or not pick them, you generate terms that are lower powers of Q.
And this is also a freedom. Yeah.
So this looks like a redefinition of Q.
Exactly, yeah. The question is whether it is exactly this freedom or not, and why, yeah? Yeah, of course there is some freedom on the right hand side as well. Okay, cool. So, as I just told a minute ago, whatever word you prefer here, we have this kind of relation, which we usually call operator product, and if we require that the multiplication as a text, we will say what are all these coefficients in terms of the other coefficients. So for example, the one will be the plus the two. And so if we impose this additional condition that L minus 1 is like 0 over the Q. So then we will deduce that beta 0 is Q to the power delta 1 plus delta 2 minus delta. And all these coefficients contain extra Q to the power 1. Yeah. So this follows from the group theory of Grassorabi, the computational relations of Grassorabi. So that's an old question, whether this group theory fact has any field theory interpretation. Yeah, and the answer is that it can be reproduced in terms of weak fields. Terms of free field means that we write this kind of thing. And we write for this announcer, which is 1 minus q to the power so the only thing which changed, I changed the position of normal ordering. And then if we expand this in powers of q, we will get remember that L minus 1 times is just a derivative. Looking at this and at this, so we want to put here L minus 1. So we will discover that the structure constant beta 1 here is alpha 2 divided by alpha 1 plus alpha 2. So, as everybody here remembers, the story is that this works in this simple way. This identification can be made only if we say that the new alpha, so delta is roughly alpha squared, to be more exact, something like this. And only if alpha here is equal to alpha 1 plus alpha 2, because of this selection rule, then this formula coincides with this. That's simple, it is alpha 1 plus alpha 2 squared plus alpha 2 squared minus alpha 1 squared divided by, well, let me move Q. It is easy to see that this is the same. So in this sense, of course, the free fields provide for us a representation of the Grassor algebra, but not an arbitrary one. The delta which arises at the right-hand side is special. So if we want to discuss some general things, we should find a generalization of free fields, and again, everybody knows what it is. Exact formula is like this. It belongs to that's an M by G. If we insert this integral, or if we insert the power of this integral, then exactly by the same tricks, we will get here a different exponent. So on the right-hand side, we will, after all these reorderings, we will have an exponent of alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus bm times phi 0. The coefficients, instead of what it was here, it will be now a little more sophisticated, so it will get 1 plus alpha 2 u defined from this term, and it will get b z I defined 0, plus so on, coming from expansion of these things. Oh, there will be, of course, a common factor of the AGT, the power of the squared, and then other factors. Beta, beta, and so then we will need to integrate all these different i's in these limits. Now, these integrals can be taken, and one can did reproduce this formula. Now with alpha, which is more general of this type. So since all the expressions are rational, all the structure constants are rational functions, well done, because we know them in infinitely many points. For discrete values of m and for rational functions, that's enough. So we know them everywhere.
Yesterday's talk by Harry, we should worry if you know something. I think that was a lot of points. It could be still good, you can't take it into consideration.
If it is not rational, it is, that's enough. Yeah. So if we are asking a question about structure constants, and this is the only question which we address in the story about conformal blocks, well done. So there is a slightly delicate point about these three-point functions, which are not rational, but are gamma functions. They are not gamma 2, they are ratios of gamma 2, and they are gamma functions. There, you can think about some small subtleties, but again, these are pretty simple quantities, which are completely under control in this way. In this sense, a story about conformal blocks can be entirely substituted by this kind of formulas. In the sense that you get your result.
If you're only interested in series expansions.
Yeah, if you are interested in series expansions before we sum them, that's true.
But if you're interested in modular transformations and so on, of course.
Of course, but I began from saying that it is impossible to ask today, is it possible to ask something about modular transformations in AGT conjecture in that primitive form which I am speaking about? Yeah? Because we don't know already what is on the right hand side for this type of diagram. Yeah? So, what I keep in mind is that in this way you can reformulate things in such a way that you will be able to make. To make modular transformations. So at this level of matrix model, which we'll write down in a moment, of course everything is possible, you can do whatever you want. But of course, if you get transcendental answers, you can question if they have something to do with the original problem, won't you? Because you should also do what is the definition in this lattice M. Not to go too far, let us take this simplest example of four-point conformal block. It is implied here that you put here a projector on my delta, and according to what I say, I was substituted by something that I will call. This is this formula, okay? This is, if this was V1, this is V2. This is what I will call V1. fact, that's enough, because the force after that drove the wedding. So this means that right hand column block, and so roughly with this vertex versus A, this N1 screenings, with this versus A, N2 screenings, and so we get a formula, which has the following form. So in terms of operators, it is and so there is now a number of screenings. It was erased, yeah, unfortunately. So the star is the operator product in terms of three fields, which is a product of two exponents at points 0 and q,
yes.
Connected with the integral of this.
To the x power.
Yeah.
Okay.
What is important is that the this is an open contour integral and it goes between 0 and q. Mm-hmm. And therefore, here the two integrals would be different. In this product, it goes between 0 and q. The result is taken at point 0. And this time, it will go from 0 to 1. So there are two kinds of of scaling changes. So this is what we get, but the point is that the integrals over y and z are different. So y goes from 0 and q, z goes between 0 and 1.
Yj?
It is here.
Oh, it's over there on the left, yes, yeah. Sorry. Yj is
here. Now, if we, as usually, we take this integral, so to get back to the expansion of conformal blocks, we need to expand the powers of q. Yeah? But q now enters in different places, not only here, but it also enters in the domain of integration. So, of course, we can rescale it to 1, but then q appears in new places. So it will appear here, it will disappear here, and it will appear here. So if we now expand all these things in powers of q, so we will get integrals which are split in y and z. Yeah, so that's an integral over z with this weight, integral over y with this weight. So in the sense it would be double average, 1 over z, so z and n 2 and y and then 1.
Yeah.
And what we are going to average is an exponent of the following type, so this q to the power of e. And here stands
final matrix model.
Sorry, I don't understand the notation. The sum of particles.
So average means that this is integral over y. There are n long y's. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there is y by j the way it is to be squared. Y by to some power to alpha 1 b, y 1 minus y, y to another power to alpha 2 b. And the second average is the same over z. Mm-hmm. Only note that instead of alpha 2 there will be alpha 3. Mm-hmm. They change, yeah. And also the n will be different. Mm-hmm. But now all the integrals go from 0 to 1.
Don't you need to talk about this integral that you need to integrate from 0 to q and then from q to 1 separately or
something? No.
If you want to expand on q minus z integral, I mean q minus z integral.
This is why it is 1 over z.
Well, technically, probably what you say
is technically, what you write is 1 in this way.
Yeah, but z goes from 0 to 1, so 1 over z. Excuse me, that
you have
two expansion regions.
Yeah, you have one expansion region for z, and another, z appears only in negative power.
It's got one expansion for one z between 0 and q, and another expansion between q and
q. Yeah, but the point is that...
The difference is some contact term which you throw in.
In principle, you can say that integrals diverge and so on. Yeah, that's true. But fortunately, there were no answers for that. So all these integrals over y and over z are just integrals of this famous state. So what you are asking is what will happen if I integrate from 1 to infinity. Fortunately, we know the answer, whether we like it or not.
Well, we know the answer for analytic continuation. If you literally talking about functions, then I will not let you change your integration.
Sure. Right. So your matrix. Let me see if I understand. So your matrix is two integrals, two matrices z and y, and you're integrating.
Yeah, of course, these are not matrices.
And that's a commutator in the exponential.
No, it's a product.
Okay.
It's a very simple expression.
There are no matrices, actually. It's like...
I thought these were supposed to be diagonal elements.
Matrix model is not a theory of matrices, yes.
Oh, gosh. I thought you were somehow converting this to an integral of matrices.
No.
Well, so you said matrix model. That's what I thought you were trying to do.
Can I comment on this?
Please, answer? Yes.
I think that for certain values of some parameters, this entire thing can be written as there are two matrices, and the result is after diagonalization and so on. But not for all values of parameters, this can be written as actual matrix integral after you go to van der Mot.
The fancy name for this is multi-panel beta ensemble. Because potential is logarithmic.
Okay.
And beta ensemble because it is not matrix.
You are summing over K here.
K goes from 0 to 1.
K goes from 0 to 1.
Maybe 1, yeah.
Yeah,
because it
double trace potential?
Yeah, but yeah, I just trace just the power of E minus E twice the power of E. So I hope it is clear what it was at this level, yeah?
Yeah.
So I said in what sense you understand this kind of differences. So after that you should expand them in logarithms, collect terms, and of course, sorry, you should multiply it by 1 over minus q to the power of the 12 of the 3, which is the and then q to some power.
If I understand correctly, this is basically this expansion, I mean, the way you just presented would have been, I would just take this coefficient and just write that same pattern. Right?
Exactly.
So then you are saying that same pattern integral in the general form and so on, when I have this number of screenings, this number of screenings and so on, can be written a la matrix integral, which probably is known for ages.
Yeah.
Okay. So now you say that there are actual matrices, and N1 times N1 or N times N2, only for that beta equals 2 or beta equals 1, but otherwise we just postulate this is our matrix.
I repeat.
Is this correct, Alexei?
I repeat, I promise to say only trivial things. So that
I'm not saying it. I just said something. Okay. Is it correct or wrong?
Once again, so I repeat what Samson said, and this is absolutely true.
Oh, okay,
so
its answer is yes.
Answer is yes, yeah. These are simply the Zenkovateyev integrals, only you should be careful about the choice of contours, yeah? And you should be careful to sum everything appropriate way and so on. And of course, as Nikita rightly noted, you should check what you got, yeah? Otherwise, everything. So what you can do, of course, you can start expanding this exponent in powers of q. So for example, pick up the first term. So it will be q to the power of the 2 plus 1 over that, and the 3 plus y. Mm-hmm. The other terms. So they are now averaged separately. You can pick up the values for this order of integrals, and you can discover that this is equal to delta plus delta 2 minus delta 1. This is equal to delta plus delta 3 minus delta delta 4, this integral. And one is divided by what we call alpha, and another by what we call alpha minus q. So in all this earlier, or what we call them today, Zenberg integrals, so denominators come already factorized. So the denominators in the formulas for all these integrals, so in this case, we come all alpha plus delta plus 2, I think. Yeah, so they already come in elementary factors. So the Dekart's determinant, which standard in the denominator of the inverse Shapovalov matrix, comes already factorized in particular factors. It is also funny to see how this converts into Nekrasov's function, which is a sum of two terms in this case, 1, 0, and 0, 1, which are, again, quite similar, but in fact, there are differences. First of all, there is no this term. This is this U1 factor, which should be taken away on the right-hand side of the AGT relation. So it will not have this factorized form anymore exponent, because you should subtract alpha 2, alpha 3 back. So to get the Nekrasov function, we should subtract this back. And in fact, it appears that you should now write it as follows. So alpha 2 plus some letter psi. This is the same. Yeah. But so you now can cleverly adjust this psi so that these two terms, now this is an average, this is an average, that one of these two terms becomes z1, 0, and this becomes z0, 1. For some choice of psi, which is something in terms of this function, psi is something like this.
Psi
H? Hmm?
Psi
H? Yeah, psi depends on K. That's absolutely unclear what it means, but there is a body.
What gauge?
How to define this procedure. But in any case, what I'm trying to say is that from this formula, the formula itself is elementary, so you can just extract any term out of it. And in one direction, it goes just literally. So if you just take this formula and do nothing else with it, you immediately reproduce somehow the conformal block expansion. And if you want to go from it to an Necrossov function, it is also straightforward, but you need to do some strange additional tricks, which are at the moment unmotivated.
Do you know the tricks that
work in higher terms it looks worse and worse. So
unless it's a universal trick, actually, I would say that two functions of same number of variables spiritually are the same.
These are quite special functions.
This is more, yeah. Did
you check the
more.
Second order?
More.
Sorry? Did you check the second order expansion?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
How many orders did you?
Two.
But you said there's some analog of this psi at the second order?
Of the story is given by these two people, of this particular story.
So there is universal. Is there a universal formula that I can...
Not at the moment, but...
Why isn't there? I mean, if you go back to the original sum of the Young diagrams, the contribution of the Young diagram Jack weights, so it's a normalization of Jack normals.
Exactly.
And I thought that you were going to say that we just expand. This is a generic function of Jack normals.
Yeah, the problem is that this is the wrong Jack polynomials. Well, that's already technical detail, so in fact, to be careful that you should put B everywhere. So you want to write Jack polynomials for 2B squared, roughly speaking, and then you should write them on this value of things.
There is a duality.
There is a duality, yeah, but
it's not obvious in expansion.
But it is not that the exponent simply decomposes into products of Jack polynomials, unfortunately. So they're still complicated linear combinations. No, they seem complicated.
One could work backwards, so start with expression down diagrams.
Once again, the problem is that there are two expansions, one in conformal blocks, another in Necrossov functions. These are two different expansions, which from this point of view look already quite similar, because they are just two different expansions in Jack polynomials of one and the same thing. And it is not very clear why you should pick up exactly these two. Yeah, there can be many different ways to decompose, and it's not clear why all the two are relevant. That's a puzzle in this sense.
I liked very much this answer you gave me on the current relations that Pakeli infinitely used to go step by step and so on. So as far as I understand, those were restricted to only four-point function, or something, it's not known on one side, because if there is such a recurrent relation to generically, I would just postulate that the right-hand side is a conformal block.
The problem is that the recurrent relation was discovered by Alexei.
Only for four-point function?
For one-point function on the torus.
Yeah,
and he didn't discover it for anything else. In principle, what he did, he analyzed what happens at the poles of Kapp's determinant, not zeros of Kapp's determinant. And in principle, the reasoning seems generalizable.
Can you restate it on the free field language and then just keep it and throw away?
That's a very good idea. Just I say that nobody did it here. Yeah? Mm-hmm. There's nobody did it. So I cannot say why it is impossible. For me, it looks quite.
What I was suggesting is guess it from free fields and then throw away the free fields. It's like modern approach. Yeah, don't throw the bait.
The really important thing is to guess. Yeah, how you do this? It's not important.
Don't throw the bait.
The bait.
Okay. Make the bait, but don't throw.
Okay.
No, I'm being actually serious, because actually the key point is that that in these recurrent relations, as far as I understand, what between them and Cartier did is that see, since there is a pure expansion in this particular integral formulas, you can check book on those integrals if it satisfies.
Sure.
No,
that's, this is what we have in mind. Yeah. But it's not that bad. Okay, since I should finish, but since Samson spoke half of my talk, I'll take another 2 minutes.
I was quite happy to
do that. 2 minutes.
5 minutes.
So, as I said, this is not a matrix model, this is multi-planar, but an ensemble. But matrix models are in fact not a series of matrices. These are the theories which are solved with the help of loop equations, with Brassard constraints, and so on. And for this, it is not important whether it is multi-planar or planar or whatever it is, whether it is beta ensemble or whatever it is. in this sense, are matrix models.
Okay.
So what is important here is still that there is beta, which doesn't need to be equal, beta is b squared in this case, yeah? So when sample charges mean different from 1, so it is not a matrix, then it is still important that there are logarithmic potentials. It is important because, exactly because they are logarithmic, you are allowed to take this open contour integrals, and nothing essentially depends on this. They are open, they won't break your algebra. And most important is that there are different contours in the key. This is in correspondence to the story known as the graph of alpha phases. And in matrix model theory, the story is, I remind you that if we have a potential, yeah, then we can put whatever number of eigenvalues here, whatever numbers of eigenvalues here, and here, and here, yeah. So we have, in fact, the answer which depends on additional parameters. These are multi-cut solutions of matrix models. In this particular case, when we have just three factors of this type, the potential is something rather special.
So Coulomb moduli will be related to this multicut. Coulomb moduli will be related.
Coulomb moduli will be related to this multicut. Exactly. These are my N1 and N2, and I hope it was clear that these are exactly the moduli. So Coulomb moduli is alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus beta N1. Yeah. So the potential will be of this form. Here is a peak, yeah, so really it has two minima, and there are two integral of a story. There will be again two parameters, N1 and N2. Though a priori they are rather different. So it's one story to solve matrix model just putting something in the minima. So how we do this? We say that some eigenvalues live in this minimum, some eigenvalues live in this minimum, and then make perturbation theory around these things. So we basically rely upon Gaussian integrals here, because the vicinity of these points are Gaussian. So the expansion in this story of the graph alpha phases, which leads to something which is maybe known to somebody as CIV prepotential. Several years ago it was a popular subject. Yeah. So it could be imitated by both the graph alpha phases of ordinary matrix models, so by the equal 1 and potential which was polynomial. So in principle, this theory is slightly different. You rely upon Gaussian integrals. Here we do a different thing. We just took explicitly different integration contours, for the reason which I am not ready to clearly explain. Just as a matter of fact, this appears to be the same. These two things coincide. This CIV prepotential, the standard one which is in the papers, generalized, of course, to the case of logarithmic potential, the beta non-vanishing integral from unity, and so on. It is literally the same as the answer which you get in this way. Why is it important? Now, first of all, it is
make some contact with another set of papers, but it is important to my story for a simple reason, because in the story of the rough phases, we know the following fact, that partition function, so the exponent of something, this something satisfies this equation. And the role of lambda there is played by what is called resolvent. No, in matrix model it would be this thing, but no generalization is clear. Yeah? So we substitute it by a sum of eigenvalues, or by ensemble, I mean. So resolvents can be defined for by ensembles as well. So we can construct this one-point resolvent. Once again, we need it for the case of non-trivial beta, we need it for logarithmic potential, and we also need it in all genera. And then, it is a well-known fact from matrix model theory that usually the logarithmal partition function will satisfy this type of equation.
You can block.
No. It is true for any n. It has an interpretation in terms of densities of eigenvalues and so on for large n, but the relations themselves are true always. At least you in France should learn this from Aina. He is repeating this story for already several years after us. Yeah? But now I think it is very well publicized. So we can do it for any n. It's absolutely inessential what is n.
I think that mathematics is international. It doesn't matter if it's France or Germany.
I don't know how often he gives these lectures. His lectures here. It's probably I am far away from all of you, unfortunately, so I don't know. Okay, so I hope it is clear how it is related to the beginning of my story, and just let me finish with one simplified example of this formula, which is related just to this Young function, where only one epsilon is present. So I said that we can define this lambda for arbitrary epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. So there are two parameters, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. The product is this string constant in which we make a genus expansion in matrix model. And another thing is this combination, which defines for us beta. So beta and loop expansion are related to these two parameters. So, but if we look at this particular formula, given epsilon 2 is equal to 0, we will get a much simpler expression for this lambda. Let me remind you that when two things are 0, both things are 0, just the basic example in the SU2 case, which one am I looking at, was just as follows. We wrote the equation of Hamiltonian of this type. Now, we were saying that this is equal to E. And we wrote an expression PD phi, and this was all of Liouville form, which was integrated in the Z equivalent theory, so Z equivalent. Prepotential for both epsilons equal to 0 is just made by this rule from this simple form. Yeah. So, in order to switch on epsilon 1, you should do a very simple thing. You should substituted by this problem. And instead of lambda, you should write log of psi, so another domain of the wave function, if you like. And the coefficient here is exactly this epsilon 1 squared. So I hope that everybody knows that for the classics, this formula P dx, yeah, which there is a whole series of corrections in H which can be explicitly written down. No, these are some complicated formulas which are
you're talking about periodic solutions.
It's a perturbation theory, so it doesn't matter. So if you want to make a Borzmer-Feld quantization out of it, of course you will say that along a contour, you will say that this PDQ will be equal to n and to 2 by n and so on. But in principle, just if you have arbitrary potential, what you do, you just put your energy somewhere, energy level, and one integral is over this thing, another integral is over this thing, and so on. Many cycles. It is so this is simple. What are the what are the contours? It is a little less trivial what is the integrand, but I repeat that you can just put the sum dots into the equation and calculate all these terms. So there are some tricky expansions, but they are well known since that is in WKB theory. And just this whole series, or any number of terms out of it, is the lambda which in this sense defines for us W. So once again, W simply satisfies this equation. Just the same as in the previous video. The only thing which changes is that now lambda is slightly different.
Common power series
in H1.
Zero is
well, as usual. But this function you also know what the series. And whatever you can sum on the left hand side, you can sum on the right hand side.
The series in the lambda has finite functions, finite convergence, what you call gamma. This is actually an actual function.
Yeah. You can check that it has.
Nick, here you're saying that W, and the Yang function is a finite function of epsilon, and the WKB is an asymptotic series in H bar.
Yeah. But since you know that there is such function,
exactly.
It has this expansion, and in this sense, the series can be summed up, yeah, as any divergent series, and can be summed up to whatever you like. In particular, to your right answer. Okay, thank you very much.
Questions, please. There was plenty of you at the top, but we can continue.
I have one comment.
Of comments, okay.
I think actually that the 1 epsilon 0 is almost a generic compared to epsilon 1 equals to minus epsilon 2 and both epsilons. If you think about 2 epsilons and the case when epsilon 1 equals minus epsilon 2 is like diagonal, the other case is when you just take epsilon 3 equal to 0 as this line, I think it's almost as generic from the supergravity point of view. Because when epsilon 1 equals minus epsilon 2, you have what they call the self-dual-gravity photon tangle. And there is some science about it. But when epsilon 2 equal to 0, it's a self-dual gravity photon, is not anymore an interpretation, because it is generic from the supergravity point of view.
This story is a sort of classical today, because it is written in Nikita's paper of 02, I think, yeah? It was discussed at that time. It is well known that for this H, which is epsilon
1. My comment was simple. I just said that that particular case, since it's connected to supergravity, as was explained by Krasov, the other case when epsilon 2 equals to 0 is almost as generic as any other value of 12. Because does it have interpretation in terms of...
Yeah, you say that we should go beyond this case, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And so I say that this case is simple in the sense that it started long ago, and everybody, I think, agreed that these are higher loop corrections follow formulation or whatever, and tau functions, whatever language you prefer. and just breaking this condition means that we should go to non trivial beta from matrix model to beta ensemble. That's slightly unusual step, but it doesn't.
In that sense, putting epsilon 2 equal to 0 is almost already a step.
Yeah, of course. But But again, this involves it to the full scale, of course. Yeah. So when we put epsilon 2 equal to 0, but epsilon 1 different from 0, that's already a fully non-trivial example.
That's what I said.
Yeah. And it is controlled by this very simple Maxwell equation. But I want to emphasize it's controlled without any word quantization, whatever. Just formulas are simply contour integrals, nothing else. The only thing to which quantum refers is just that you need to take this lambda for this lambda monodromy of the.
Well, I mean, in that sense, I would say that when you go to the higher rank case, then it becomes actual Maxwell equation.
Exactly.
In that sense,
it is Maxwell
equation. You know, what I mean is that in this moment, you can mix the Maxwell equation because it's a Schrodinger equation thing. But when you go to higher rank case, it's actual Maxwell equation, non-trivial.
Yeah, of course.
No,
what I said, you can. No, this model has a trivial generalization to SUM things, yeah? Just instead of putting here.
Yeah. So
we put here a generic polynomial of degree n, if you want to describe the Sivanov case. So here we put generic polynomial, and so put here this equation, that's again Boxer equation. And again, consider the same quantity p d phi plus corrections coming from solving this equation. And this is the
But my comment was on this was that I was saying that then it becomes a real Boxer equation, and there we call it quantization. I mean, Boxer called it quantization. So I'm saying that it's a kind of playing of words, but still, that's what the Maxwell equation does.
Yeah, so but I am emphasizing another part of the story. It is called quantization, true. But the prepotential or Young function or whatever is defined by simple contour integrals, still. You don't change this
I agree with you.
This, whatever is the word, Zeiger-Peterson theory or whatever, it is preserved. The only thing which gets quantized is this. Is this quantity. And in this sense, you can still think that this is a classical integrable system, but some non-trivial classical integrable system.
Do you think that lambda still satisfies an equation lambda squared equal to something?
No, it satisfies, unfortunately, what I said.
So
this type of equation. It is a highly transcendental function. It's quite difficult.
No, actually, I would.
The spectral curve is fully quantized in
sorry,
this
sorry.
Sense. It has infinite genus. And
I want to go back to that. It doesn't have a class.
Let people ask questions.
Samson is not asking questions. He's making state.
Right.
No, I think AGT can actually the state.
Translate the proposal for the performance to matrix models in a precise recipe. So given given a particular say quiver diver, we want to calculate the Hinson-Ton sum. Now what do I have to do? So how to put the ends exactly and so on. And the ends are the actual point.
To write down a conformal block, you need to agree in what order your indices, your views go. So, for example, for this diagram, so this Q was much smaller than this Q, much smaller than this Q.
I said this, I wanted the matrix was.
Yeah, but this defines everything. So if you have this hierarchy, you have some order in which you make operator product. So in principle, operator product is associated. But constructively, if you look at series, you need an order. So when you draw any type of such diagram, you imply some order in which things are multiplied. So you get. Then you write what I mean. So you write the V1 times V2, then times V3, then times V4, then V5, and so on. And with each such product, you associate its own.
Okay, you're telling me that the matrix is ultimately absolutely irrelevant unless we have a second point of here.
This is what I'm saying all the time. I prefer the word free field. There are no matrix models. Matrix model theory is not only here anyway. Matrix model theory is a theory of free field. Another formulation. These are roughly, no? Just they always give tau functions, tau functions are always
If you introduce appropriate variables, so there are tau functions in terms of time, which you should still have to potential times, and then it will be a tau function. Whatever is your background potential on its. No, it's a question whether these are the same things as the methods model. Yeah. Methods model, these are just the key to the power of the
computer. I don't understand my question. I know if epsilon is my epsilon 2, I can
Rewrite
the partition function in terms of free fractals. Then the gauge theory times translate into double and it's an empirical statement. This is also a tau function. This is an unusual type of software.
No, in my opinion, it's a trivial statement, but in case it's...
So, I don't know how to do it for general
epsilon. Yes, if you say that this is tau function, you should be able to write it as free from the
So that's why...
Other questions?
Thank you.